I am Brad Keelor. He is Ryan Berg. Find out next on Director's Cut, the humble beginnings and meteoric ascent of Geotech Tools and how he was involved. Hello again, everybody, and welcome to Director's Cut. My name is Brad Keelor. I'm the director of the Geo-Institute, and that is why we call it Director's Cut. Every week, I sit down with a different GI member who has a story to tell, and this is where they tell it, and we are fortunate for that. I guess every week until I get fired or something dramatic happens in the world and we decide to not do this anymore. If you like what you see today, and I think you will, you can always click the subscribe button. You can click get notifications. We will let you know every time we post something to the channel. Today, we are thrilled to have with us one of our 2021 award winners, and we will talk a little bit more about that later in the show. It is Ryan Berg from Ryan Berg and Associates. Ryan, thanks for doing this.
Good morning, Brad. It's great to be here.
I think we're going to have a good time today. We always try to. There are two questions we ask every single guest, and the first one is this. Describe your job in 45 seconds.
Good question. I guess I would say I'm a boutique engineering firm, small firm. I specialize in providing services to transportation agencies, forensic evaluations, construction material evaluations, and litigation support. So really just a boutique type of geotechnical consulting firm.
And you struck out on your own quite a long time ago. How long have you been doing this?
I've been in business a little over 30 years. So,
what do you think has been the most challenging aspect of running your own show?
I think it's the multi number of hats you're wearing, and it's not so much different as from a one-person consulting firm to a multinational consulting firm. You're always landing the work. You always need to be careful with your contracting. You need to perform the work. You need to make sure it's high-quality work. You need to keep people involved with their professional organizations to stay on the cutting edge of technology, stay current. You need to have timely invoicing and timely payments. And during all of that, when you're as busy as can be doing work, you need to make sure you keep marketing to get additional work to keep the pipeline full. And like any consultant would say, never promise more than you can deliver, and always deliver more than you promise. So
I think that's a good answer. There were a lot of little things in there, and I think anybody who's ever worked in or run a small business can appreciate that. Even us, I always tell everybody at our conferences, if everybody gets food on time and there's enough of it, 95% of the complaints will go away. So you got to take care of those little details, and everybody's happy.
Right. And I have to remember to take the garbage out on Sunday nights, too, so...
Always important. You don't want to miss a week.
That's right. That's
especially right. In the summer. So we go into some fun questions here on Director's Cut too. And so we're going to hit you with one of those right away. What food do you eat the most frequently?
Well, I grew up in Wisconsin, so I think I'm obligated to say cheese. All right. So you got to eat cheese, you got to promote cheese, and you have to root for the Packers.
Is promoting cheese part of the deal? I mean,
sure. Your cheese heads, yes. You got to wear the hat every once in a while. You bet.
So there's got to be a follow-up question to that then. You got to rank your top, I don't know, either three or five types of cheese. What are your favorites?
Oh, sharp cheddars, baby Swiss, and then... blue cheese.
There's a lot of diversity there. That was excellent.
Well, that's what's good about cheese. There's a lot of diversity there.
That's true. The baby Swiss, I like that choice in particular. Why is that superior to the regular?
I don't know. Just the taste, texture. I don't know.
I love the butteriness of Swiss. I think that's my favorite part about it. So next up, we're going to ask the one we teased in the opening here, but you're going to lead us there. What project in your career required the most creativity?
Yeah, that's a pretty difficult question. I've been around doing work for a long time, so there's projects where operations and construction sequencing drove the design, and those have been challenging. There's been projects where we're on the cutting edge of a technology and we are up on top of the steep learning curve and breaking new ground. So those are always challenging and risky. There's other projects where just the unexpected come up and everybody's scrambling to address unforeseen circumstances and so forth. So there's a variety, but if I think of a more current project or recent project, going back 10, 15 years ago now, is the Sharp 2 project that developed Geotech Tools. And that's the Geotech Tools that's now being hosted at the GI website. And that was challenging for several aspects. One is the vast amount of information we were reviewing and distilling and critiquing and distilling down into usable products. The really extremely large research team we had together and diversity of the research team. So there were a lot of strong opinions, a lot of great ideas, a lot of long days in meetings, hammering things out and directions to go and so forth, because it was such a broad project. We all had to be going the same direction, but took a lot of discussions to get there, a lot of refinements on the work products as we went through them. And the biggest challenge, I believe, was that early on, we wanted to do something different. We didn't want to produce a stagnant written research report. We wanted something on the web, something that could stay alive, could grow over time, and that would continue to be useful to engineers, geotechnical engineers in particular, but also pavement engineers, structural engineers, planners, administrators, and so forth. So we had that goal, and that was a lot of work to get the National Academy to accept that. And then it was a lot of work to organize and pull together the Geotech Tools.
So Geotech Tools, for our viewers, if you have not used it, you can access it by visiting geoinstitute.org. There are links all over the place. You will have to create an account, but it is free. We have over 11,000 users. It's chock full of case histories. You can learn a lot there. Ryan, when you look at Geotech Tools now, what about it would you not have expected when the project started?
I think one of the things that surprised us was it was directed initially directed primarily at transportation engineers, and the users grew very quickly in the U.S. and Canada, but the international crowd jumped on it very quickly. So we're really thrilled with the worldwide set of users we have. So that shocked us or pleasantly surprised us. The other thing I'm a little shocked by is the lack of contributions that come in sometimes by users. So we're still searching for a way, I think, to solicit a more regular source of contributions by the users.
Well, that's great. And hopefully all of our viewers, if they haven't checked it out, will go and do that after they watch the rest of the interview.
Sure.
Don't click away just yet, because there's a lot of good stuff to come. So the next one, you brought up the Packers already, along with your support of cheese. What sports team do you hate the most, and why?
All right. Well, now I live in Minnesota now, so I'm living across the river. So, and hate's kind of a strong word. If I think dislike, and if I think of the hometown Minnesota Twins here, I have to say we dislike the Yankees. They've just simply edit the Minnesota Twins playoff runs way too often. It's just like a wall that they can rarely climb over.
I'm very pleasantly surprised by that response. I thought, as a fan of a team in the Packers division who comes from that large city by the lake, I was afraid this was gonna get ugly here for a minute, but I can definitely support your Yankee dislike. That's I think about those Torrey Hunter teams, especially in the early to mid 2000s, and that was tragic every year when the Yankees would end their season. Yeah. But I feel like there's always hope for the Twins though. And they kind of come out of nowhere when you least expect it. Because then in 87, didn't they win like 85 games or something? And then
won the series. Yeah, 87, yeah. 91. Yes. So
beat the Tigers in 87. And I was very upset about that. But, you know, 34 years later, I've moved on.
Maybe you have.
Well, forget that Matt Noakes couldn't hit a ball anywhere other than directly at the right fielder. So we talked a little bit about you starting your own firm early on, and now we're going to get into another question about that. What was the scariest thing for you about starting your own company?
Well, it was a long time ago, so you know, I think I wouldn't really say I felt like anything was scary. I felt I was well prepared to open my own firm. I'd worked for several different organizations, small consulting, large consulting, construction material manufacturer. So I had sales experience. I had a lot of consulting experience. But there are, again, a lot of challenges that one faces. So you have to stay focused, and you have to wear many hats and prepare, get the work, do the work. Make sure it's good work. Make sure you have good contracts. You have to invoice, and you have to collect payment on a timely basis, or things don't work. And during all of that, you also need to keep up with your professional organization, so you stay on top of your specialty area. Stay current. And you also have to be marketing the entire time to make sure you keep the pipeline full. So those are some of the challenges.
So you kind of served this one up on a platter then, because you've mentioned professional organizations twice, which is amazing. Yeah. That's not a response we usually get, so I really appreciate that. The other question we ask everybody on the show is how you first got involved with ASCE and GI.
Well, that's an easy question. I got started with ASCE my freshman year at University of Wisconsin-Platteville with the ASCE student chapter, and have been involved ever since. They have a large civil engineering program. The faculty was very supportive of the ASCE student chapter, and a couple years prior to that, they had won the Robert Ridgway Student Chapter National Award, so a very strong program there. So I've been involved with ASCE since college. The Geo-Institute, I've been involved with them since it started up 25 years ago. Just a natural progression.
Perfect. So what do you think? I mean, this is always easy. I hate asking people what their favorite thing is, but I think we're going to go with that here. What is your favorite thing about being involved in ASCE? I mean, there must be something good to have made you stick around all these years.
The interaction with colleagues, the amount of knowledge you can pick up quickly. It's great to learn from other people's projects, successful projects, poorly executed projects, and so forth. But you really want to stay current. But most of it is, you know, the fun you have with your colleagues when you can get together at conferences or other venues.
Good selling points, and that's another thing you can do at our website for everybody watching out there, is if you are not a Geo-Institute member, we have about 12,000. We would love for you to join us. Geoinstitute.org, click the links. You can be a member in probably less than 10 minutes. We would love to have you. So we're in the back half of the interview now. We got a couple more fun ones, a couple more serious ones. I'm going to ask you another question about the Midwest. I am from the Midwest. I don't like it when people call it flyover country, or they make some stereotype about it, and I get really annoyed. And so in your opinion, what's the most misunderstood thing about the Midwest?
What is the Midwest geographically? I grew up alongside the Mississippi River, and this direction's east, that direction's west, and I don't know where the Midwest is. It's just, I don't like the term at all, actually. North Central, that maybe fits, but Midwest, no, I just don't like it.
I had a roommate who spent some time in Montana, and he tried to convince me that that was actually the Midwest, and that Michigan, where I'm from, he had some other name for the region, and I didn't really care for that very much. And it made me upset when Penn State joined the Big Ten, too. We're getting out all my grievances here in one episode of Director's Cut. Because I thought that Pennsylvania is not the Midwest. They have hills. That can't possibly count. So another thing that you've done a lot throughout your career is develop a lot of training courses. What part of developing those courses was the most difficult for you? Like especially when you started up, and how have you managed it over time?
Well, going all the way back to when I started up, that would have been the early 90s. We really were directing training courses more towards like a university lecture setting. And that's not the way to get through to adults that are paying jobs and are taking time out of their work to come study. It needs to be interactive. It needs to be more focused on things that they can use right away and direction on where they go when they have questions and so forth. So over time, the refinement, the better sharpening of these training courses to be adult education focused has been a learning curve, but it's been an enjoyable curve to go through and see how much better the products are now. Challenges in developing the courses, I would say, I've been very lucky to work with a very broad-based group of subject matter experts, of geotechnical subject matter experts. And so, you know, any engineer, if you ask them to talk about their specialty area, they can talk for hours, they can talk for days. So one of the challenges is, how do you fit all of that information? How do you distill that talk into lessons and key points and what should be addressed in face-to-face education and what should be referred to later reading and so forth? So in addition to having these, you know, great subject matter experts, I've had really very good subject matter experts from the client, from the Federal Highway Administration. So you have a lot of very strong opinions. You've got a ton of material, and you have to distill all of that down into a usable format. So there's a lot of discussion, a lot of negotiating, trial and error, but we get to the finished product and everybody's happy with it. But it's a bit of a process.
So what about you as an instructor? I mean, was there like a light bulb moment where you just said, hey, I'm getting pretty good at this and I should try and repeat these things over and over again? or do you feel like it was more gradual, or did you just get it right away?
Oh, I didn't get it right away. No, no. No, I think this aspect of adult education and focusing in on key points and not just coming in and spilling your guts about everything you know about this subject, but focusing on key points and telling them when to go to the reference manual, that was a bit of a progression. And when you did that and when you worked with interaction with the students, you said, oh, this is working good. Yeah, they're right. This is the way we should be teaching.
That is great. So we got two left, and maybe we're going to have a bonus question here.
All right.
I'm thinking a lot about the twins now, Ryan. It's not good, but we're going to spin it positively. So for Ryan Berg, how would you spend your ideal Friday night?
Ideal Friday night for me would be watching a sunset someplace different in the world with some family members and or with friends, but somewhere completely new. Maybe on top of a mountain, maybe on a dive boat, but somewhere completely new.
Any cheese involved?
No.
Maybe there's got... No, really? I feel like it goes with everything. But that's a great answer. Where's the favorite place that you've seen a sunset in your life?
Oh, let's see. One that comes to mind would be on the Zambezi River in Zimbabwe. So sitting on the river and watching the sunset and watching the hippos in the shallows and the crocodiles and
did you guys
set from the top of the Giza pyramids. We bribed our way into staying up there till after dark one time, and it was all good till the sunset, and then it just got very eerie.
Well, so then how hard was it to get down then? I mean, it's got to be pitch black there.
Yeah, but there were lights down, but they do a light show down below, so you kind of worked your way down as the lights were flashing and that, but yeah.
And the other one, those are two really good choices there. The Zambezi, you guys doing some whitewatering?
No, this was on a pontoon boat and cocktails, so.
So definitely no class 5 rapids for that thing. No. Well, I mean, I guess you could have tried. I don't know how that would have gone.
We were right above Victoria Falls, so that would have been a
tough that's excellent. Wow, that's a good answer there. I like that. So the final question here before we get to the bonus one, I mentioned at the top that you were an award winner this year. You have won the Kapp Award this year, which we can talk a little bit about what that means in a moment. And Ryan's going to receive his award, hopefully, at Geo Extreme in Savannah in November. What aspect of winning that award means the most to you? And when you got the call, what did you think?
Well, I was thrilled, and the aspect that means the most is that, you know, this type of national award is a recognition of your work by an honor from your colleagues. So really, that's it. It's have my colleagues recognize my work.
And it's going to be fun. I mean, I think one of the things that I missed the most over the last 20 months or whatever are the award ceremonies that we do, because everybody's happy during the award ceremonies. You know, we do the nice pictures and everything, and it is just a lot of fun. And I think there are a lot of people who have the same mentality as you, where it's so cool that, you know, somebody nominated you. You might know who it is, you might not know who it is, but there's somebody out there who thinks highly enough of you that you are the best for that year at that thing. It's almost like going into the Hall of Fame, I think. And so that's got to be our bonus question then, because we made it through the 10 here. Your favorite twin of all time and why?
Oh, my favorite twin. I don't know if you'll know him or not.
I know them all, Ryan.
Pat Neshek, reliefer.
Oh, I know Pat Neshek.
All right.
That's an excellent choice. I think I'm going to have to go. My favorite, I loved Kirby Puckett when I was a kid, but I grown up a Tiger fan. I still had a little piece of me liking Jack Morris.
Oh, of course. What a World Series he had for Minnesota. Yeah, he was fantastic.
But we went to the first game back in Detroit for Morris when he pitched, and he got hit in the kneecap by a line drive in the second inning.
Ooh.
And got booed off the field. And I felt a little bit of pity for him at that moment in time. But I like Neshek. That's an excellent choice. What led you to him?
Well, he's a family friend.
Oh, that's even a better answer. That's easy. I thought it was going to be the unorthodox delivery or something like that, because that's what I always remember about him, but I like that. So, Ryan, you made it through everything. Thanks for doing a good job representing the Midwest. We need a little more publicity in the world. And again, all the viewers out there, if you liked what you saw today, and as I always say, you probably did because you're watching at the end, click on subscribe, click get notifications. We will let you know every single time that we post something to the channel, which is frequently. Go check out Geotech Tools. Go check out more about your Geo Institute membership. Ryan did a great job selling the benefits today. Maybe we're going to have to put him on the payroll for that pretty soon. But Ryan, thanks a lot. All right, this was fun today.
Thank you. It was fun.
And we will see everybody next week.